Hello, Narnach here. This is my video update for February. I can't believe it's February already. I mean, time has really, really flown by. January is just snap gone. For my feeling, 2 weeks ago it was Christmas, and 2 weeks before that it was the beginning of November. The last couple of months have been a blur, but it's been a really fun blur. So, as always in my video updates, I look back on what I've done since the last video update, take a look at the current state of my channel, the series I'm doing, the games I'm playing, and I look forward to my plans, what I got, the plans I have, the games that I'm looking forward to that are being released, and just generally go off topic as I tend to do at all the times in my normal videos. In the background here you see the Division. I played the beta weekend last weekend and had a blast with it. So I figured rather than showing some Path of Exile or something else in the background, let's do something with the Division. So let's have a look. So last video was just was in the beginning of the new year, and I just passed the 100 subscribers mark. Currently, we are over 140 people here, so the channel is growing. So to all the people who are still here, I'm glad you stayed and hope you will continue enjoying it. Let me know if that changes. Don't leave, just let me know. And to all the new people, welcome. I hope you enjoy it and hope you will continue enjoying this for a very long time. So we now have over 60,000 views. A lot of that was due to just the enormous popularity of my latest Path of Exile series for the Talisman League. So I play a hardcore shadow that uses the new chaos skills that are got added to the game. And for the first time ever for me, I went beyond normal difficulty. I completed cruel difficulty. I actually lost my character on the first day of Christmas in Act 1 Cruel, and I rebuilt the character in I think 2 full days of playing, and then I continued and haven't lost my character since. And right now I'm on Merciless, which is the final difficulty of the game. I just made it to Act 4, which is the final act of the game, and I've actually started on mapping the endgame of Path of Exile, and I'm having a blast. So I'm really discovering a lot of things, and the chaos skills, the combination of the chaos skills has been really interesting and new to play. And well, from the popularity of it, a lot of you seem to enjoy it as well. So glad you like it. So there's a lot of challenges ahead with that, but I'll get to it with that. But Path of Exile has been one of the very popular things. Besides that, Duskers started the second season because my old save game was basically from 10 beta releases ago, and a lot of features got added to the game. And legacy save games basically had infinity for things that now got limited. So I actually was playing with a rather overpowered ship and set of drones in a world that was much more optimized for limited constraints. So with the addition of some new story elements, I decided to start a completely new game, and boy, is it more challenging now. So that's definitely fun, but a lot of you seem to like that one as well. Grim Dawn, been just slowly going over time. Actually finished the series, but that turned out to be rather popular as well. So actually so popular that I've decided to start a new series with that. Just waiting for the next beta release, and just to keep an eye out on what the plans are for the release of the game, how far that is going to be after build 31. So right now I have just over 470 videos on the channel. So I keep releasing 2 videos a day, sometimes 3 a day. Rarely I release 1 video a day, just some very rare days. But during the last weekend, last Sunday, I actually released a single video because I was playing the beta. So It's the rare occasion where I will drop a secondary series. I mean, Path of Exile always goes on. I always play Path of Exile, but sometimes I sacrifice my secondary or tertiary games for doing something else. And The Division did result in a recap video afterwards. So that's a bit of balance. So, yeah, let's dive into current state of things. So, I mean, I'm still doing this as a hobby. I mean, there's 140 of you. I really enjoy that you're all here, but app money is not a way to get rich. So it's a hobby. It's fun. I really enjoy it. I just will just continue doing it as my hobby. But that also means that my time is limited. I do this in the evening hours, in the weekends, and every once in a while, real life intrudes and does take over. But that said, I have been able to stick to my schedule of 2+ videos per day rather consistently in the last, what is it, in the last month since the last update. Two and a half episodes per day, that worked out pretty well. I'm actually gonna see if I can make it a bit more streamlined, so it will be just 2 episodes a day rather than sometimes 2, sometimes 3 episodes. Because that third episode, it does basically means that I'm just recording stuff the entire evening. And there's a lot of new games that are coming out, and I just don't have the time to dive into them because I have obligations, at least that's how I perceive them, to continue with the series I have. And yeah, I need to find a balance with that. I mean, that's basically been the theme of the last half year. Just finding a balance between having a YouTube channel, trying to maintain multiple series on it, and on the other hand, just playing games for fun, and also just playing games for the channel. I want to cover as many games as possible, but some games are not very suitable for the channel. I've had some interesting discussions in the last week with some people in the comments of some videos about possible games I could play on the channel, and some games I've already played. So I'm just gonna recap that here, because that way I can just share it with everybody, and you get to know me a little bit better. So I've been playing games for over 20 years now. I mean, I'm 30 years old. I started playing games on a Atari 5200 when I was a kid. I was 6, 7, 8 years old. Not quite sure how old I was, but it was around that age. That's when I started playing games, Pac-Man, Tetris, things like that. And over the years, I have grown along with different gaming platforms. So after the Atari, got different of the Nintendo consoles. I got the NES, the 8-bit version. I think I skipped the Super Nintendo, but I did play some of the games at friends. Went to the Nintendo 64, which was a massive upgrade at the time. 3D games, James Bond, GoldenEye. Wow, that game was awesome. Perfect Dark, ultimate shooter on consoles. I was actually good at console shooters back then. After that, I got more into PC gaming. PCs became a bit more capable, and just have been going from there. And I've played a lot of the old games. I've played, Wolfenstein, Doom, Quake, Unreal Tournament. I've played most of the classic shooters. I've played strategy games, Command & Conquer, Red Alert 1, Red Alert 2, Total Annihilation, which eventually got followed by Supreme Commander, Supreme Commander 2, Planetary Annihilation. So on the strategy games side, I've played role-playing games. I've played Baldur's Gate on a computer that couldn't even install the full game. Because Baldur's Gate, originally it came on 4 CDs. So each CD contained 700 megabytes of data. So all four cities together, if you would install them, I think the game came about to about 2.5 gigabytes, which at the time, I think my hard drive was 1 gigabyte. But you could do the thing where you installed only certain chapters of the game. So if you installed the first chapter, then you could start the game and play it through. But only if you wanted to progress to certain parts of the game did you need to install other parts of the game. So I was really juggling things, but those are classics I played. After that, now things like Icewind Dale, Neverwinter Nights, played a bunch of roguelikes, actually before the whole revival with the roguelites that you have these days. I played the classics, I played Rogue, I played Angband, I played Sea Angband, I played Ancient Domains of Mystery, which actually got a Steam release recently, which is awesome. It actually has a graphical shell and a lot of improvements, so I'm really happy that the developer finally managed to get it onto Steam and actually earn some money for all his hard work. What else? Basically, I've been gaming for ages. I got into MMOs a bit later than most people, just because I grew up in a small village where internet was not really a thing. We got connected to the internet rather late. I did for a while. Actually, we had a modem, so I played Diablo 1 via modem. That was actually the first multiplayer online game I played a lot of. Probably way more than was healthy for my parents' phone bill, but yeah, it was fun. With Diablo 2, I actually played that. I think I've played Diablo 2 with the Lord of Destruction expansion for over 10 years. I think it got released around the year 2000, and I played it well into the early 2010s. With friends, just weekly games that would just keep going, always on hardcore, always very challenging, just pushing ourselves, putting up arbitrary limits just to see how far we could push ourselves to become better players, to work within restrictions, to experience all kinds of edge cases of the game, and just be really creative in overcoming obstacles and just focusing on becoming better players, which is with Path of Exile is now my main game. And Path of Exile really, in my mind, it's a better successor to Diablo 2 than Diablo 3 is, just because Path of Exile it has the same thing of there are a ton of viable different builds. It's very much about player creativity. The game it can be very challenging, but once you know the game and you know where the challenges are, you can prepare for it. And the game it rewards player skill. If you are a very good player, you can get quite far with modest gear, so to say. If you contrast that with Diablo 3. Diablo 3 has devolved into a game where it's all about numbers. Your player skill rarely matters. It's all about the numbers. It has a very strong influence from MMOs in that regard, where, you know, the difficulty in the game, it scales up by just increasing the numbers to beyond ludicrous. Recently in the 2.4 patch, they finally added a thing where, rather than showing the full number, which goes into the billions and hundreds of billions and thousands of billions on higher difficulties of monster health points and also damage that you deal, now they actually abbreviate it into K and M for thousands or millions of damage points that you inflict, just to make it readable. It was I think in the 2.3 patch, it was a really big thing that they added commas or periods, I think, in between digit groups, depending on the different countries' preferences for separating number groups. just to make it easier to understand, if your enemy had 150 million health points or 15 billion health points, because now that's an order of two orders of magnitudes of difference. But if you have like 10 numbers in a row, it's really hard to see if it's 10, 11 or 12 numbers in a row. So yeah, and I think with Path of Exile, it's more true to its roots with Diablo 2. I mean, in Diablo 2, you could have a character that was nude, as it was called. So basically, you have zero items equipped. Everything your character was the skill points you had assigned and player skill. And with that, you could defeat the game on hardcore, on the highest difficulty. It was possible. People have done it. I haven't, but people have done it. And Diablo 3, you just can't. Heck, you can't even finish the first act of the game without wearing any items, because your items give you stats, which basically give you damage, and everything scales off of that. All your spells scale off of your damage, which scales off of your weapon, and it just goes with that. And yeah, Path of Exile is completely like Diablo 2 in that regard, where gear is just a means for getting sockets so you can equip skills. And a lot of skills, the melee skills, obviously they use your weapon, so they build off of weapon damage. But a lot of the caster skills, they just skill by themselves. So if you have like level 1 gear and only caster gear, you can get quite far in the game without being completely tied down because you don't have enough statistics. So I really appreciate that, and that's... It's rare for me to get sucked into a game that much and to play it that much. Because as this very, very long-winded thing has been going on, basically what I'm trying to say, I've been playing games for 20 years and I've played a lot of them. Eventually I got into MMOs. I've tried MOBAs a bit. MMOs, I played a lot of them. I was a bit late to the party, but I did try a lot of them. So I've played EverQuest 2, actually quite far. I've played some World of Warcraft. I've played some Warhammer Online when it actually was still alive. Rift, played a lot of Rift actually, which was fun because that also has some progression stuff going on and with the different soul paths and character builds. I like games where you can have character builds, where you can customize things, where you are not playing the same character as everybody else is. I mean, if you have a class and there's like two or three different builds, and that's it. And if you, you know, ask someone like, hey, what kind of sorceress are you playing? And it's like, yeah, I'm playing a fireball sorceress. And, you know, that's it. Then there's no subtlety, there's no variations, there's no nothing. Yeah, there's just one build because it's optimal or it's the only thing that's viable. I tend to lose interest very, very quickly. And because I've been playing games over a long time, and I'm a very analytical person, I like to analyze stuff and just see what makes something tick, what makes it up, what are the construction blocks that make up something, and how you can, you know, combine things. So I've been analyzing games for a long time as well. So every time I play a new game, the first couple of hours I might get sucked into the story, and if the story is really good, the story might actually carry me quite far. But at some point I'll start picking up like, yeah, this story, it's a bit like the plot of that game or that book or that movie, but recycled and rehashed, and it's not actually quite original. Most video games actually have just terrible stories. It's rare that they are good or original. Most of the times they're just rehashes. And most of the time, stories in video games are just an excuse to give you something to do, to provide you a narrative that moves you forward in the game, to allow you to progress. So that's okay. I mean, you don't expect high literature from games most of the time. Some games actually do, but it's a rare thing, and most of the time you're not looking for that. You're just looking for entertainment and an excuse. So then for me, game mechanics are what drive me. If the usually if a game is very simplistic, if it only has a couple of game mechanics, I get bored really easily. Once I figured out how the game works, what makes it tick, and there's nothing more new to learn, nothing new to try, then for me the fun is over, because I like the exploration of the game mechanics, just discovering how things work. That's what makes a game fun. So to get back to Path of Exile, there's just so many different character builds I haven't played yet. So I know there's a lot left for me to explore. Currently playing on Merciless, mapping, discovering things there. There's whole new sections of the game that I haven't played before that I'm just discovering for the first time, and I'm enjoying it because it's all new. And I'm just seeing how things work, what the extremes are, how far you can push things, where you shouldn't push things. So that's very fun. So if I'm playing a new game, that's how I approach it. I analyze it. And if the game keeps coming up with new mechanics, with new things, with new ways to combine elements of the game, then that makes it fun for a longer time. But if you have a... So that's where I think the distinction between good games and bad games comes in. Good games do new things. They don't just copy-paste an existing game and reskin it. They do something new of their own. Because, let's say strategy games. In the late 90s, strategy games were the main genre. So a lot of the strategy games that came out were just copies of other games. So if you had played Red Alert, the Command & Conquer and Red Alert series, there wasn't a lot of extra value to playing games that had similar mechanics, because they didn't really do a lot of new things. So I think there were clones there. And then suddenly Total Annihilation came onto the market, and it was completely different. It was actually the first strategy game that had 3D rendering, where the world was in 3D, where height was actually a thing. And if you put a big Bertha cannon in a valley between mountains, and you had stuff on those mountains, if that big Bertha cannon was trying to shoot at things that were on the other side of the mountain, that cannon might actually shoot your buildings on top of the mountain, because the buildings were in the line of fire. Things like that. Just the whole perspective and the scale. You had hundreds of units, which at the time was mind-blowingly many. The map wasn't grid-based. It was fluid, like we are used to now with strategy games, that you can just send units wherever and not have them stick to grid tiles on the map. That was completely new then. Streaming economy was a big innovation that series of games has been the only one that actually did it. So Total Annihilation in that regard was a good game, because it took elements from an existing genre of games and added new mechanics, new interactions, and it made something that was new and unique all of its own. And that's something that, with MMOs, you had a couple of MMOs that were really big and popular, and then everybody started making MMOs. And there were some ideas that some MMOs that just cloned other games, because hey, now we have an MMO as well, but that's been reskinned into World blah. But it didn't really add anything new. And that's a genre that's now dying, because there's just too many and people are moving on. MOBAs, that's the same thing. You got Dota, you got League of Legends, you have Smite, and you have Heroes of the Storm. Those are the four big ones. And I don't think there's going to be a lot more that will stay, because a lot of the MOBAs that get announced in early access or beta, most of them don't even make it to launch. They already get scrapped and cancelled before they launch properly. It's just the way it is. If they don't offer anything new or unique, there is no space for them. I've played a lot of games, so I tend to get very easily bored of games, which is rather annoying because, you know, for people who haven't played a lot of games, if they buy a new game, they might enjoy it for weeks or months on end, put hundreds of hours into a game. I might be bored after two evenings, which actually it's my loss because, you know, a lot of potential fun is just not there for me. So when it comes to picking games to play on my channel, I have to make that as a conscious choice as well. If I look at a game, I have to estimate, okay, how much time can I put into it? Will it be fun to play? Will it be fun to show? Will it be fun to watch? And won't I get bored of it? Because I don't like to stop a series when I'm in the middle of it. So if the game gets boring, that's just annoying, because then I lose my motivation. And if I'm not motivated, it's not fun to watch either, because, you know, I'm doing it half-heartedly. So that's why I pass up a lot of games, as, yeah, I'm not gonna get into them. That's very story heavy games as well. For example, Pillars of Eternity. I think I put 40 or 50 hours into the game. I was just checking through my list of games to see what I've played and how much, but I've put that much time into it. And oh, it's a very good RPG. But at some point I got to the harbor in the big town. I did all the quests there and did some quests in the major town as well. And at some point, like, yeah, now what? I've experienced a part of the story. I've experienced quite some combat. I think I had my character level 6 or 7. So they had unlocked quite some abilities. And it's like, yeah, I don't really feel compelled to go on. So rather than like, yeah, I want to play it every time after I get home, like, yeah, let's continue with the story. It's like, yeah, don't have anything else to play. So yeah, that's why I tend to pick games that I can finish a series in like 10 to 20 hours. So that way there is a limited time, and it works good for just my limited attention span, so to say. So that was a really big unexpected talk about that. So let's actually do a recap of my current series. So Path of Exile, that's my main series. That's gonna stay my main series, one episode every day, with the Winterheart season leak event thing going on right now. I might occasionally post two videos per day, one for Talisman League, one for Winterheart. But that's Talisman is my main thing. The expansion is coming up in March, so once the expansion is out, I'm gonna switch to the Challenge League that comes with the expansion. Of course, expansion is gonna be a game changer, literally. All classes, all 7 of the classes will get subclasses. There's gonna be 19 subclasses in total. 3 for all the main ones and 1 for the Scion, which is main speculation for everything. What's the Scion gonna be? What's the Scion gonna be? Probably gonna be a Super Scion. With big yellow glowing hair. That's my guess. Might be off on that, but I think Super Saiyan might actually be a thing if they can get the licensing just right. But Path of Exile, I'm just gonna play that. I'm really having fun, and I don't think that fun is gonna end anytime soon. And as long as I have fun, I continue. Grim Dawn. I actually finished my series. It was a bit unexpected. I'm very honest about that. I defeated the end boss of the game, and I looked at the map. I was like, okay, this was just a warm-up for the actual endgame end boss. It was a 15-minute battle with the end boss. But because the map did have more content after the actual fight, I was like, okay, so there's going to be another boss after this, because, you know, one of the NPCs disappeared during the fight. So I have to save that NPC or something. But no, that actually was the end boss. The fate of that NPC is unknown. So basically that hints like, hey, yeah, there is an expansion coming up because we have to do something with that. It's the same trick as Diablo 3 did, of course. So yeah, that ended a bit awkwardly, but hey, that's the thing of discovering a game for the first time. You don't always know what's going to come up. So if things end awkwardly, then if the game ends awkwardly, the series ends awkwardly. So next playthrough with either build 31 or with release, depends a bit on the timeline of how things go. For now, taking a little bit time off from Grimdom and spending a bit more time on just my other series and on some one-off things like the Division beta recap. I'll get back to Division later. Fall of the Dungeon Guardians. That's man, that series is turning out to be way longer than I was expecting. Currently, I'm in level 8. And I think there's 15 or 18 levels. So I'm halfway there or 40% there. Depends a bit on how things eventually turn out. Difficulty's ramping up. Puzzle difficulty is ramping up. Last episode, I actually spent 20 minutes trying to solve a puzzle. Turns out it was not a logic-based puzzle, but it was actually just a movement pattern you had to find by trial and error, which, yeah, it's there's a reason I don't play a lot of puzzle games and adventure games. Let's keep it at that. I get frustrated by those things very easily if they're not based in logic. So, yeah, I actually cut out 20 minutes of my recording to just condense it. Which I think in the end was a lot more fun to watch for you than the full thing would have been, because I got really, really frustrated. But yeah, I'm just gonna continue with it. I like how the game has been developing as I was playing it. I mean, I picked it up just basically on, I just saw it in the Steam list as it got launched on launch day, and I've been playing it ever since. And as I've mentioned before on vlogs, I've got some contact with the developer, and the developer actually watches the videos. So playing through the game, it feels like almost like playtesting. And if I encounter bugs or if there's weird inconsistencies in the interface, I spot them, I analyze them, I describe them, I try to formulate how I perceive it, how I was expecting things, and how maybe things could be better. And that's things like I have, for example, my sometimes a character is in a weird state. I have no clue what my character is doing, because you can queue up some abilities, and then the thing is, okay, so the ability that was in the queue, I don't see the casting animation on screen. I don't see it queued up. There is a cooldown, but I haven't seen the effect yet. The resources haven't been consumed yet. And if I hover over my character portrait, it doesn't show anything. What's going on? So I speculate about that just in my video. And the next day, there's a patch. And then if you hover over the character, it shows what the character is doing. Things like that. At some point, I encounter a talent upgrade where it says, well, yeah, a certain skill gets an extra tick of damage. Okay, so but how much is tick? How much seconds is that? How does that work? Get fixed. So I really enjoy that. I mean, I like analyzing things. I like improving things, and I really like how indie developers are on top of things and provide a level of attention and care to their games that all the AAA developers can learn something from. So, no, the game development is a very tough business. It's very tough to sustain the business, to keep earning enough money to fund your next games and to actually make a living off of it. So, and actually most of the fun I've had with games has been with indie games. So that's why I try to play a lot of indie games and, you know, support them that way. And especially if you have a developer that watches videos, and by just playing it and giving feedback, you can help improve the game for potentially thousands of people that are playing the game. I think that's a really cool thing, and I think that that's a really nice privileged position almost that I'm in, that I'm able to do that, and that I've actually that my videos and feedback has been both entertaining for a lot of people to watch, but also qualitatively good enough that some developers are paying attention, that I can help make the games I like even better just by playing it and giving feedback. And that's for Fall of the Dungeon Guardians, that's about half of my driving force, because I know the developer is watching and I know I can help make the game better. And I play games differently than other people do, because I'm half beta testing, playtesting things rather than being completely immersed and forgetting about everything. So I always have that analytical thing going. And yeah, it's something unique, I think, that not a lot of other developers do, or not a lot of other YouTubers do. So that's a fun thing to do. So that series, I'm going to continue every 2 days. It's just it's a secondary game right now, because no, Grim Dawn is not there, so Dungeon Guardians takes up the slack. Duskers. Next up, another indie game where I've got some contact with the developer, and just I'm trying to help him improve the game by providing feedback and going through it. And I'm actually pleasantly surprised at how the popularity of that game on my YouTube channel has actually slowly increased. It used to be there were like 10 viewers of every episode in early season 1. And I think now there's about 30 people that seem to follow the series. So over time, it actually has gotten more popular. And especially though, season 2 is way more dramatic than season 1. Because season 1, I started with a very old build. And a lot of new systems and new things that made the game harder got added during my playthrough. But I didn't want to lose my drones, because I was really attached to my drones. So I didn't do a restart of the game until season 2, where a lot of new story based things came in. And the game is a lot harder, a lot more challenging. There's a couple of interesting new angles that I think can make the game even more challenging. I've provided some feedback to that, so they might make it into the game, they might not be. We'll see how that goes. I know the developer is planning on a release in the near future, which will add a lot of new things involving more ambient sounds and more hints about events that are gonna happen. So if you pay attention, you can actually anticipate things like radiation leaks and things like that. So yeah, I'm having a blast, and I really like how Duskers pushes my emotional buttons. I get really... I used to play it very analytical. In the very early betas, I played it very analytical. I played it almost like a puzzle game. Almost like it was Sudoku. Back then, if you had a motion sensor, it had perfect coverage in all the rooms around it. So you could literally determine what rooms had monsters by opening doors to adjacent rooms. You could have monsters come in. And that way you could check if rooms were clear or not. And you could almost, Sudoku style, like just map out which rooms had monsters in them, which ones didn't, and just walk around them or deal with them with guns and things like that. Over time, the reliability of motion sensors has gone down. So some rooms are not scannable, and the more difficult the derelict is, the more difficult it is to actually scan rooms, and the more rooms are not scannable. So you have to fall back on other ways to figure out where things are. Sometimes you just have to resort to putting a drone in front of a door with an armed turret and just opening the door and hoping nothing comes through. And if something does come through, hoping you shoot it before it shoots you. But the game, especially when things start to go bad, It really hits you on an emotional level. You feel paranoid, you feel desperate, you feel frantic. You don't want to lose things. It has a really visceral reaction that not a lot of games manage to evoke. So I really appreciate it for that, because not a lot of games evoke emotion. And because it evokes emotion, I think it's one of those games that really is worth playing just to experience that, because it makes, it's something unique. Puzzle games, programming puzzle games. So that's TAS-100 and the Human Resource Machine. Human Resource Machine, sort of, kind of technically finished it. I solved the last puzzle in the game, not optimally. I didn't finish the most challenging extra level in the game. Somewhere in the future, I hope to go back to it and finish it. But the thing with programming games is that they take an incredible amount of time to make. And it's an unpredictable amount of time to make. That's maybe the worst bit of it. So, for example, Path of Exile, most of the times I can sit down, do my daily quests to warm up a little bit, like take 20 minutes to warm up, and then I can just record an episode. And if I, most of the times when I sit down, I record multiple episodes in a row. So it's a very predictable way. Within 1 hour, I can record an episode. Grim Dawn, same thing. Don't even need a warm up for that. Because I'm not playing hardcore, I don't have anything to lose. Fall of the Dungeon Guardians, same thing. Sit down, do a sound check, hit record, and record an episode. Duskers, similarly, but programming games are differently because you're solving a puzzle. And actually, Fall of the Dungeon Guards, with some of the puzzles, I've noticed that if I can't solve it, it's a puzzle, so it can take an arbitrary length of time to actually finish it. But with programming games, by definition, you have to solve the puzzle before you record it. And the earlier puzzles, they're doable. They're relatively simple. But the further you get, the more complex the puzzles get. The more you have to think about it, the more you have to analyze it, the more you can just get stuck on something. So if you plan to sit down and record an episode of TRS-100 or Human Resource Machine or any other puzzle game or programming puzzle game, you sit down and it might be that the hour or 2 hours or 3 hours that you allocate for recording an episode might not be enough because you just get stuck and you have no way to figuring it out how it goes. And it might be that, you know, if you just spend like half an hour on a puzzle trying to solve it, put it aside, sleep for a night, or take a bath, or do something to not actively think about it. It might be that in the background your brain just continues crunching on the puzzle, and then the next day it's like, hey, Eureka, I figured out how to solve the puzzle. And some of the more difficult puzzles you might actually need more than a couple of days to let it soak in. But I figured, I mean, that's really hard with the timeline I keep for myself, because most of the time I record episodes for the next day. I record one day in advance, sometimes 2 days, but it's been hard to actually build up a buffer because I don't really have a lot of time to do this. So 1 day in advance is most I can manage. With a programming game, it could be that a programming game can just soak up an entire evening and not result in a video at the end of the evening, which for the channel is not a good thing because no video is not good. If I spend 3 hours on other games, I can easily get 3 videos, maybe even 4 or 5 videos, depending a bit on if I record multiple episodes of a single series or if I record different series at a time. So, there's a reason I put them into the bonus category. So I will just record them when I feel like it, when I am in the mood for some programming games. I'll pick up TS-100, probably, and just work on the last series of puzzles and see where I go with that. Human Resource Machine, the very difficult puzzle involves prime factorization, which is actually a tricky problem if you have a proper programming language. If you have an assembly-like language like you have in that game, it becomes even more difficult to deal with. So, I haven't been able to crack that one just yet. So, and there's also the thing that those programming puzzle games, they get watched less often than the other games. So it's also an effort reward kind of thing. If I record a video on another game, more people will watch it, more people will appreciate it. So that time is basically better spent to entertain you. as you, as all the people watching those games, rather than the programming games, which is a really a niche interest. So, yeah, for now, my attitude on those things is I'll not even schedule them. I'll just do them if I feel like it, when I feel like it. Okay, so that's my current series. Then future stuff. The Division. I played the beta, did a beta recap. I was very unsure of the game before I played the beta. I'm now convinced. I actually bought the game, so I when it comes out on March 8th, I will start playing it. March 8th is a Tuesday, so from what I hear, the game has about 20 hours of solo content, and after that, it's PvP, PvP, PvP. PvP in that game is very enjoyable. My best friend is also, we played together in the beta. He also really enjoyed it. PvP was a lot of fun. We actually made some in-game friends with some other guys that were nice to play with. So when the game launches, if they also decide to buy the game, we might play with them as well. Might make some other friends. Some other offline friends also are interested in the game. So depends a bit on what we're going to do with the multiplayer part. But the PvE side of the game, my current plan is to just play completely through it and record everything and have a series for that, just for the PvE side. On the PvP side, of course, there's no storyline, there's no things like that. So I might record a video, multiple videos, depends a bit, or maybe some highlights or stuff of gameplay. But I really feel uncomfortable recording everything, including voiceovers and things like that, when I'm just playing with my friends. Because the dynamics are different when you are recording stuff, knowing it can be potentially broadcast to thousands of people on the internet, rather than when you're just playing with your friends and just, just having fun. Yeah, I'll have to see what I do. Maybe I'll just record stuff, but never actually broadcast the audio. So that way, the gameplay's there, and I'll just do voiceovers. I'll have to see what I do there. So that's wait and see. That's basically it. XCOM 2, that's coming out this. Actually, it's going to be tomorrow at 11 o'clock in the evening, European time. That's the official release date. But actually, with some friends, we have a release party planned at our office. So, we're gonna have a couple guys there, and we're just gonna start playing in the evening, and we're just gonna play and play and play and play. And at some point, we'll probably fall asleep just on our keyboards, and we'll wake up with key imprints on our faces. It's gonna be fun. It's gonna be glorious. So I'm just gonna play that for fun for me. I'm not quite sure what I'm gonna do for YouTube yet. I might do a recap or something, or this is XCOM, just to show you the game and my take on it. But yeah, I'm excited about that one. Next up, Factorio. Release for that is planned late February 25th, if I remember correctly, but yeah, the release, I don't think there's an official date yet, but that's going to be the Steam release, Steam Early Access, actually. So, Factorio, it's a factory building game, heavily inspired by Minecraft. I think the developer, the original developer, actually wanted to first make it as a mod for Minecraft, and then realized that it wasn't possible to do it within the context of Minecraft, and actually just built his own game engine to do it. So it's top down, it's 2D, and it has a very solid gameplay. So you play the role of basically a crash-landed astronaut. It's a bit like The Martian in that regard. If you read the book or watched the movie, it's a bit like that. You crash-land on a planet and you have to survive. While in The Martian, the guy completely goes nuts on building a potato farm to survive. In Factorio, you don't have to concern yourself with food, which is actually quite a luxury. So all you have to concern yourself with is basically reinventing all the science you need to build a rocket to get yourself off of the planet. Problem is, as you build up a factory with different fabricators in it and conveyor belts that ferry stuff through and mines. And you start researching things and you start pumping up oil and converting it and spewing up all kinds of toxic gases into the atmosphere. The local alien wildlife starts to take notice and not appreciate what you do. So on top of just building a factory, you also have to defend it against aliens that really don't like you being there polluting their planet, and can't blame them. So that game was actually on Indiegogo back in 2013, and I backed it. And I've been following it ever since. So I played the very first public releases for the game and been following it over time. And the game has really, really just developed into a very solid game. The gameplay was already very solid back in 2013. It has only gotten better over time. So they're now going for a Steam Early Access. And then, given the pace of development they've been going, there's probably going to be a major release of the game every 3, 4, 5 months, which will add a ton of new features, then followed by weeks of bug fixes and extra additions and tweaking and stuff like that. That's been a pattern they've been keeping up so far, so I'm assuming that that's going to progress. But it's a lot of fun. It's a huge time sink. Factorio is a huge time sink. I've got games that I think that the first game I actually finished, I played 40 or 50 hours on. I've currently got a game that's, I think I'm 40 hours into it, and I'm not even close to finishing it, because finishing it is defined as completing a particular end path in the tech tree. But the game is more about just building a factory and discovering the world around you and setting up defenses and dealing with it, rather than just rushing for the tech tree. I mean, if you do a speed run, you can finish the game in 4 or 5 hours. If you play the optimal tech tree and then build a minimal factory to achieve that, 4 or 5 hours, you're there. But the fun in Factorio isn't just building something, a huge sprawling factory, and eventually converting everything to solar cells and trying to minimize your pollution, and just building bigger and bigger pipelines of materials coming in and fabricating stuff, and eventually equipping like power armor and having combat drones with you and doing stuff like that. So the Steam release is going to be in late February. And I've always been wanting to go back to it. I mean, some of the very first videos on my channel are actually Factorio videos. I think I've got a 4-part series that I started in January 2015. And it's one of those series I never really picked up after I resumed my channel in May. Because at that time, I put hundreds more hours into it. And at that point, I was just kind of burned out a little bit on Factorio. So, but yeah, I know Factorio is a time sink and there's a lot of stuff coming up, so it's really hard to make or find time for that. So I want to do it, but I just have to see how I'm going to fit it in, especially, you know, coming weekend is going to be absorbed by XCOM. Last weekend was absorbed by The Division. During the week, I have my, quote unquote, regular obligations. So I'll just have to see if and when I fit it in, or maybe I'll just start a series very close to the Steam launch, rather than having something already prepared. Besides that, a long time I've been wanting to do something with Europa Universalis 4. Actually, in early December, when the Cossacks expansion was released, I figured like, hey, this is a good opportunity to actually do a series for the game, but I'm 60 hours in, and I feel like I've basically just completed the tutorial. I understand where to click to make certain things happen, but by no means I understand the game. And especially, I don't think I've ever played a game that lasted more than 100 years. I've been backstabbed so many times by previous allies and things like that just left my empire in ruins, where, yeah, I'm not quite sure if I'm gonna... I mean, in my mind, if you do a playthrough, you want to do a full playthrough. On the other hand, Europa Universalis, man, that's a tongue twister. In that game, EU4, part of the fun is just in seeing the stuff that happens if you do get backstabbed by your allies. How do you deal with it? And basically the drama around all of that, the story that you built of your own, that might actually be the whole point, not finishing it, just crafting stories as you go. So yeah, I'll have to see what I've been wanting to do, but again, it's going to be a long series, and right now I don't have space for a long series. That's the problem. Same goes for Crusader Kings 2, which actually had a expansion released yesterday. So that's actually the first time I did a proper playthrough. I actually bought the game, the collector's edition of the game, when it was on a discount sale. Because that's when you buy games, especially games with a ton of DLC, you wait for discount sales. And most of the time when there's an expansion release for one of the Paradox games, so EU4, Crusader Kings, things like that, all the old games go on sale, like 60-70% off. So that's a very good time to pick those games up if you have even a remote interest in them. Because it's going to save you probably over €100 or dollars or whatever in costs if you would compare to just buying everything full price. So yeah. But CK2, it's like Europa Universalis in complexity, but it has a completely different focus. So rather than building up a nation and conquering the world, you're building up a dynasty. It starts in the year 1066, and you build up a royal dynasty. So it's more about the people, their backgrounds, their characters, the relations all the people have with each other, the people that get married, the plots, the intrigue, all the backstabbing, and it's. I mean, yesterday I played for I think 3 or 4 hours. And I started the new player campaign tutorial thing, so where you take over as the King of Leon, which is a part of northern Spain. So the situation was I had my small kingdom. Next door was the kingdom of, to the east was the kingdom of one brother who wanted me dead, because he was my heir. Because my character was not married and had no children. So my brother was my heir. To the left of me was my other brother, who also had a small kingdom, who was actually married, didn't have children, and therefore I was his heir. So, and to top it off, also had a sister who ruled a province somewhere, actually was married and had kids, and was conspiring against me basically to strip me of my power because she wanted to take over my kingdom. So there you already have it. That's one family in three kingdoms, all conspiring against each other. And I think after 4 hours of playing, I actually ended up in a political alliance with the guy to the east who wanted me dead. But we needed each other to fight off the invading Arabs from the south, because that was the time when the Moors invaded. I was conspiring with the wife of the king of my brother that was living to the west against her husband. So actually was in a secret romance with my brother's wife, and we were plotting to kill him, and we were basically trying to set up the entire court to recruit allies and things like that to just get him dead, so he would die and I would become king and we could rule the United Kingdom together, while my sister, who had ambitions to take over my kingdom, was actually basically trying to do the same thing to me. She was actually trying to get into a romantic relationship with me, all the while in the political arena trying to establish factions against me to strip me of my power. So it's really nice how in just such a short time there's just so much drama and intrigue and interesting stuff that happens. And that's something I think would be really fun to, you know, just share and showcase. But on the other hand, I barely know what I'm doing, so I actually have to just take a good look at the tutorials and do all of them rather than only a couple before even diving into the new player campaign, because there's just so many game mechanics in there, and a lot of them are not in places where you would expect them if you come from a EU4 background. So yeah, that will take something to learn, but it's something that eventually I want to do a series for that as well, because it's just going to be so much fun. Besides that, a couple of weeks ago I started playing a little bit of Blade and Soul, which is a MMO in which you play basically a ninja with a lot of sword fighting and combat, and the combat is solid. It plays a little bit like a fighting game, like Mortal Kombat, things like that. There's combos, and depending on where you are and the conditions you've applied to your enemy, you will unlock different options, different combos, different moves. It's a bit like the combat in Aeon used to be, an MMO 5-6 years back, but just way deeper. But I've come to call it Crash and Blade, or Blade and Crash, because for me it's just not a stable game. It just crashes quite often. So I've been very reluctant to even record anything about it, because at the current state I just can't recommend playing it, because even though it's fun, it's just not stable. And I really want NCSoft to just fix their shit before just going deeper into it. Earlier I spoke a little bit about indie developers and profitability. Something that came floating by this week on Twitter is that Arcen Games, who've made a lot of very interesting cross-genre unique games in the past, actually has financial difficulties. They've had it before in the past, and once again they have it. So Arcen Games, they've made AI War, which is a grand strategy space game which is asymmetrical. So basically in the far future the AI has won, artificial intelligence robots have conquered the universe, and there's little bits of patches of humanity remaining. But you know, they're like ants. They are everywhere, or they live, but you as a human, you don't notice them because they are far beneath you. Well, the AI is similarly minded. No, humans have been dealt with, they're not worth paying attention to, so whatever. They have their own thing to do with. But you lead the last little bits of humanity, and you try to reconquer space from the AI for humanity. So you're always fighting up against a giant, and you try to you don't want to push too far, because if you draw too much attention onto yourself, the AI will take notice and just overwhelm you with superior numbers. So it's no hit and run, and there's hiding and things like that, and it's an incredibly nice and deep game, but it's very hard to get into. It's very complex. The graphics are, it's not a very pretty game. The gameplay is solid. And now for me, gameplay trumps looks most of the time. So that's how I first learned of them. After that, they made Tidalis, which is like a match tree game that has a lot of depth, but because it's a match tree game, not a lot of people actually paid attention to it, because like, yeah, no, match tree, whatever, don't care. And I think that actually almost cost them their studio, because you know, they were betting on Tidalis making a lot of money, and it didn't. And suddenly, there was no money coming in. So they actually rallied to community and came out of that. And they've actually made a number of games afterwards. They made a sort of procedurally generated platformer game, which I can't... A Valley Without Wind, that's it. Which I've actually followed the development on the blogs about it. And that game actually morphed completely 3 or 4 times over during development, and it's completely different from what it was originally intended to be. But It's a platformer with random elements, character progression, and a lot of interesting things that are not normally done in 2D platformers. They made a game, a god game. Actually, what was it called again? I'm so bad with names. I've got it here. It's also Skyward Collapse. Yes, that's it. In which you play a god game similar to like old games like Populous, where you are the god of a people. And you shepherd your people along. The thing is, in this game, you are the gods of two opposing factions. And you lose when one of the factions wins. So you actually have to balance them against each other. Which is, it's a completely interesting concept. Normally in a game you try to win. Here, if you win, you lose. The way to win, or to not lose, is actually to keep everything in balance and to make things grow over time, but preserving the balance. So that was a very interesting interesting concept, and I'm happy that game exists. More recently, they made The Last Federation, which combines strategy games, more like 4X like space strategy, but not quite, because there's no big universe to conquer, with a bullet hell combat mechanics. And again, it's a very interesting concept. They take different genres, combine it, and it's a fun game to play. I spent a couple of nights playing it, and I had a good time. And because I always just get really quickly distracted by games, I played their games a couple nights, and then I've had my fun, and it was worth my time. And now, if you're not like me, you could probably play it for weeks and actually finish the game and have a good time. So recently, they've been working on a grand strategy 4X title for a long time. That was their next big project, but I think they were running out of budget, because they've been postponing the launch date of that game for multiple times already. So they were faced with the decision of no focusing on that and betting on it, or doing a quick game in between and hoping for to make some money out of that to finance the next game, because revenue from all the games was drying up. So they were, you know, stuck with some financial difficult choices. So they built Starward Rogue, which is a bullet hell game set in the Last Federation universe, actually. But rather than a bullet hell game where you just fly a ship in a single direction, it's more like a roguelike, or roguelite. I think roguelike is reserved for games like Rogue, but roguelite, it has procedurally generated maps. It has, the map is tiles, or I think they're not actually procedurally generated. The levels are actually as they are, but there's like hundreds of different rooms that got linked to each other. So the level is actually procedurally generated based on maps that are hand designed, and things link together, and there's boss fights and all kinds of things like that. And I suck at bullet hell games, but I had a fun hour or two, or however or long I gave that. But again, they combine different genres and different elements and make something that's new and unique. And yeah, I'm sad to see that they actually, after Starward Rogue was launched, they actually had to fire most of their people because they just couldn't afford to pay their wages anymore. So I've also been meaning to just play some of their games and showcase them on the channel, just to, you know, help spread awareness, but time.
Plus the fact that for most of those games, I haven't played them a lot. Or I'm not quite good enough at them to feel that I can properly showcase them. So it's been on the program, but I've been keep postponing it. And now, for example, you know, Division Beta weekend came up. So this weekend wasn't a Arcen Games weekend, but it was a Division weekend. And things keep shifting. And yeah. Wow. So the background video is actually cycled for twice. So that means I've been recording for more than an hour now. That wasn't what I was expecting. But then again, it's been... I have a lot to say. So if you're still with me, I thank you for your patience. I think that's also kind of where I'm gonna end this. Oh yeah, one other game, Thea, The Awakening, which is a very interesting strategy game where you are a god who's been stripped of their powers, guiding a village of people. Sort of kind of like in a civilization like setting, but it's just one village rather than an empire, and you send them out on quests, and it's almost like an RPG where you have a party of people, but you also have a village where you can have multiple people in multiple parties, and it's interesting like that. But the battle mechanics in that game are very nice. It all evolves around a card game, and depending on type of fights or challenge, the characters and cards take on different meanings, and you play the same game, but different cards and different characters get different abilities and different meanings, and the win conditions are different, and the starting conditions are different, and the stakes are different. I mean, if you play a straight up combat, if a character dies, the character dies. If, for example, you are hunting for animals, then if you lose a character, the character doesn't die, they just get removed from combat. And if you lose the entire fight, you just fail at hunting monsters, so you actually have to resort to combat. But if you win at a hunting challenge, you actually don't have to fight. So if you have non-combat mechanics in your party, sometimes you have a better way to deal with a challenge than just straight up fighting. And it's very interesting. The card game, it took me a while to understand how it worked, but I think it was interesting enough that I eventually want to showcase it on my channel as well, just to say, hey, this is Thea, The Awakening. It's fun. I enjoy it. You might enjoy it as well. And especially now that I don't have Grim Dawn for probably the coming couple of weeks, things like that, I actually have some space in between everything to showcase that. So, yeah, I think that's really it for this update. I'm probably going to do another update next month. See if I can maybe get a monthly schedule or something going. Because I think it's nice to just every once in a while just stop and evaluate where you are, where you've come from, where you are, where you're going. And just, talk about random stuff that gets on my mind. So with that, I'm going to stop because my throat is actually getting really, really dry and I'm starting to lose my voice. So I need to drink some water and I don't have anything in front of me. So that's a very good reason to stop as well. So with that, I thank you very much for watching. If you've all made it all the way to the end. And I hope to see you again next time. Bye-bye.